to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
Come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17. Welcome to our series of lessons entitled Soul-Saving Lessons. In today's lesson, we're dealing with the subject of coming out of denominationalism. Is it God's will that we be divided and name ourselves after groups started by men or certain teachings in the Bible? Does God want us to have division, or is it against the will of God? As one studies the Scripture, it is clear that we are called out of division, out of denominationalism, and that we must stay true to the unity that Christ Himself prayed for. In our series of lessons, each one has been designed to help us see the truth of God's will, to preach the truth in love. Today's lesson is no different. We're not doing these series of lessons to make fun of, to belittle, to anger anyone. Rather, we want to provoke one another to love and good works. How do we do that? By preaching the truth of God's Word, 2 Timothy 4, verse 2. And so, when we think about coming out of denominationalism, let's realize it's a lesson designed to provoke us to study the Scripture, to want to do the will of God. We're not claiming that there are no sincere religious people out there. There are sincere religious people in denominationalism, but you can be sincere and be sincerely wrong. Romans 10 verse 2, some had a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. We need to make sure that we've obeyed from the heart the form of doctrine that God has delivered. This lesson is designed to simply speak the truth in love. Ephesians 4 verse 15. The Scripture says we must buy the truth and sell it not. Truth is the most valuable commodity we could ever have, and if we get it, we need to make sure and hold on to it. We need to let the truth run free course in our life and never change, because that's what's popular. And so we're here to speak the truth, but we're here to speak the truth in love. Proverbs 27 verse 5 says that open rebuke is better than love carefully concealed. If we said we really loved your eternal soul and we knew there were things that were being done that weren't according to the will of God and we never said anything about it, would that be real love? No, that wouldn't be real love. Real love demands that we say what God says out of a motivating factor of wanting people to ultimately go to heaven. As we think about coming out of denominationalism, why must one come out of denominationalism? Here are some reasons why denominationalism cannot be God's will. Denominationalism divides the body of Christ and is against the Scripture. If a person is in a denomination, it is a division of the body of Christ, and it cannot be right. Jesus prayed in John 17, verse 20 and 21, I pray that they all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they all may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. Jesus prayed for oneness, for unity, and that unity proves to the world that Jesus is the Son of God. If unity proves Jesus as the Son of God, what does denominationalism prove? It shows that Christians, those who, quote, claim to be Christians, can't even agree on what God and Christ taught. It's not the will of God. Ephesians 4 verse 3 says we're to endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. We're to have spiritual unity based on the bond of peace, which is the Word of God. I want you to see God's ultimate view of unity. Notice what the Scripture says in Psalm 133 and verse 1. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. God says it's good and it's pleasant. It's my will that you dwell together and be unified. Now, denominationalism cannot promote unity. 1 Corinthians 1, verses 10 through 13, we're going to learn it's against the will of God. Let there be no divisions among you. If denominationalism causes division, and if division is wrong, then naturally, denominationalism is wrong. Secondly, denominationalism, one must come out of it because it's just not authorized in the Word of God. Must we do all things according to the pattern? Hebrews 8 and verse 5 teaches us by principle that we must. Must we ask the great question, is there any word from the Lord? Jeremiah 37 verse 17. Do we need to be concerned with what does the Scripture say? Romans 4 verse 3. Absolutely we do. We need to have the mindset of John 2 verse 5. Whatever Jesus says to us, we need to do it. And let's realize, Jesus and God have not authorized, the Bible does not authorize denominationalism. Matthew 28 verse 18, the Scripture says, Jesus has all authority in heaven and on earth. Now, if that's the case, and it is, where did Jesus say, now you go be a part of this group, and you go be a part of that group, and you be a part of this one, and you're all okay? That's not what Jesus said. Jesus never authorized division in the name of Christ. Some people today say, well, it doesn't matter how you get there. We're all just on different roads going to the same place. That's true. All who are in denominationalism are on different roads going to the same place, eternal destruction, because it's not the will of God. Colossians 3:17 says, whatever we do, in word or deed, we've got to do all in the name of or by the authority of Jesus Christ until we can find where God says, divide in my name. There's no authority for denominationalism. Not only is it not authorized, but in Scripture, denominationalism is explicitly forbidden for the people of God. Now, where's that at, you ask? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and I want you to see what verses 10 through 13 says. Now I plead with you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it has been declared to me concerning you, my brethren, by those of Chloe's household, that there are contentions among you. Now I say this, each of you says, I am of Paul, or I'm of Apollos, or I'm of Cephas, or I'm of Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? Don't you see here the clear command not to divide? This is where denominationalism is explicitly forbidden. Same mind, same judgment, no division among you. Be perfectly joined together. Is that what denominationalism does? No, it does the exact opposite. Now, let me show you from this passage that what we have today is just as wrong as what they had then. Were you to ask most people whom the letter to the Corinthians was written, are you a part of the one universal church? They would say, sure we are. We're just a sect who follows Apollos. He's a really eloquent man. Or we like Paul. He suffered for the Lord. We follow Peter. We can relate to him. Or we're followers of Christ. And so you've got this big universal idea, and then you've got these sects coming off of it. Was that right? Paul said, let there be no divisions among you. Now, bring it down to our time today. Were you to ask most people and press them on the issue, they'd say, well, ultimately, we're all a part of that one big universal body. We're just the sect that follows the teaching on repentance. Or we're followers of Martin Luther. Or we're followers of John Wesley. Let's hear it again. Let there be no divisions among you. Just as it was wrong in the first century and explicitly forbidden, an exact parallel is denominationalism today, and it too is against the will of God. And so you cannot be divided and denominate and expect God to be happy. Another reason denominationalism is wrong and one must come out of it is that it follows the teaching of men, not of God. Can we follow the teaching of men and be right with God. 2 John 9 says, whoever transgresses and goes beyond the doctrine of Christ, he doesn't even have God as his Father. If we put men's doctrine in, we need not call God Father, for we have severed ourselves from Him. Revelation 22, 18 and 19 says, if we add to or take away, and if you follow the doctrine of men, you've got to do one of those, then you're going to have the plagues written in the book of life. We're not to go beyond what's written. You can't go beyond what, stay within the boundaries and not follow and follow the teaching of men also. 1 Corinthians 4, verse 6. The Scripture says, we're not to add to His Word or take from His Word, lest He rebuke you and you be found a liar. But I want you to see a passage in Scripture where people in Jesus' day were trying to follow the teaching of men and the teaching of God. And Jesus said, you can't have it both ways. Look at Matthew chapter 15, beginning in verse 7. Jesus said, hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy about you, saying, these people draw near to me with their mouth, they honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Why? In vain they worship me, teaching as doctrine the commandments of men. Denominationalism is against the will of God because it teaches for doctrine the commandments of men. If Jesus didn't ask for it and you can't find it in the Scripture, where does it come from then? It comes from history of men. It comes from our opinion. It comes from prejudice and bias that men have, and we interject that into religion and somehow think God's going to be okay with that. Denominationalism is a sin because it follows the teaching of men, not God. We're just as much a hypocrite today if we say, yeah, I'm a part of the body of Christ, we just follow such and such. No, you either are or you aren't. You're either a member of the Lord's body, you're either a member of the one church Jesus built, or you're in denominationalism, which is against the will of God. Another reason that denominationalism is something a person must come out of is because it creates unnecessary confusion and doubt among the world. Is God the author of all this confusion and doubt? Well, let's look at the Scripture and see. Notice the words of 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 33. The Bible says, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. Is God the author of confusion? Absolutely not. If denominationalism creates confusion and doubt among the world, John 17, 20 and 21, it disproves that Jesus is the Son of God and God's not the author of confusion, then we need not be involved in things like that. You know what's great about God and God's plan of salvation? God's plan is clear and it's simple. John chapter 8, verse 32 says, you can know the truth, and the truth can make you free. When you read, you can understand. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 4. We need not be ignorant, but we can understand the will of God. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 17. And so as we think about why denominationalism is wrong, let's realize it is based in confusion and doubt, and we must not be a part of that. Now, let's think for a minute about some biblical passages, some specific passages that will call one out of denominationalism. The first is Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 4. The Bible says there is one body. The oneness of the church of Jesus Christ ought to call people out of denominationalism. Now, what do we mean by one body? In Ephesians 1, 22 and 23, we learn that the body is the church. If the body is the church and there's one body, how many churches are there? Just one. Jesus only built, and He only promised to build one church. Jesus did not say to Peter, upon these rocks I'll build my churches. Matthew 16, verse 18, Jesus said, upon this rock, the fact that I am the Christ, the Son of the living God, I'll build my church. The rock, Jesus Christ, is singular, and the church is just as singular. There is only one body. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 24, Jesus is only coming back to receive one kingdom to the Father, and the kingdom is the church. Matthew 16, verses 18 and 19. And so since the Bible teaches, there's just one church, That calls me out of denominationalism. The scriptural head of the church ought to call me out of denominationalism. Anytime there's a group who says, we're going to look to such and such city, to our head, for a decision, I need to run out of there as quick as I can. Because the Bible says in Ephesians 1, 22 and 23, that Jesus is the head of the church, which is the body. He's still reigning from heaven. Hebrews 1, verse 4, God's word is already settled. Psalm 119, verse 89, and we do not need a head supposedly on earth, whether it be in Rome or Salt Lake City or Springfield, Missouri, wherever it may be. We do not need a head making decisions today. The church is not decapitated. Jesus is still the head. The scriptural founder and owner of the church ought to call us out of denominationalism. Who owns the church today? Acts 20, verse 28, the Bible says, Jesus purchased the church with His own precious blood. Who paid the price? Jesus did. Who's the owner of the church? Jesus is. Who's the founder? 1 Corinthians 3, verse 11 says, no other foundation can any man lay except that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. If He's the owner and He's the foundation, then any group who has some founder among men today or men of the past, that's not the church you read about. Any group whose founder or foundation is not Jesus, that ought to encourage us to get out of denominationalism. But then there's another passage that calls us out of denominationalism, and that is God's biblical plan of salvation that we find in the Scripture. Kind of in a nutshell, Acts chapter 18, verse 8. Many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed, and were baptized. When we look at God's plan of salvation, it's very simple. Men and women hear the Word. They believe in Jesus. They repent of their sins. They make that good confession just as the Ethiopian eunuch did, and they're baptized in water for the forgiveness of their sins. Acts chapter 22, verse 16. Any group that teaches a plan of salvation different than that is not God's church. It's a group that was started by men, based on the doctrines of men, and it will never get anybody to heaven. And so when we look to the Scripture, we can see, I need to be called out of. Here are passages that do. And if a person has come out of denominationalism, you must never, ever go back into that. How sad it is when members of the body of Christ who held the pearl of great price in their hand sometimes go back into the way of error. How horrible and filthy of image that is in Scripture. The Bible describes it as returning to the way of error, returning to the filth and the muck and mire of sin. Let's illustrate it from Scripture. What's it like when a member of the body of Christ leaves the church and goes back into whatever it may be, error, worldliness, sin? Notice the words of 2 Peter 2, verses 20 through 22. For if, after they have escaped the pollutions of the world, through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. For it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. But it has happened to them according to the true proverb. A dog returns to his own vomit, and a sow having been washed to her wallowing in the mire. Look at the disgusting picture of the person who leaves truth and turns back to error, whether it be into a world of sin, whether it be back into denominationalism. How does God view that? If you escape the pollution of the world, you turn back to it, it's going to be worse for you, God says. Why is it worse? Because now you know what you had and you gave all that up. Think about the two images, how disgusting they are. It's like a dog returning to his own vomit. Ugh, what a disgusting picture, you say. That's how God feels when a child of His leaves the truth and goes back to error. It's like a sow, a pig having been washed, returns to its wallowing in the mire. Look at how pretty it was, and then it jumped right back in the mud hole. That's how God views one of His children leaving the church and going back into denominationalism and religious error. And thus, we suggest that you must never go back, because being eternally lost will be worse for you mentally. Now hear me out. I'm not saying that if a person who is a worldly person and a person who is a member of the Lord's church who fell away, that the same fire won't burn on both of them. Luke chapter 16 teaches it will, but Luke 16 also teaches we'll be able to remember. Son, remember, Luke 16:25. If as a child of God, a member of the one church, I leave the truth, I go into error, it will be worse on me mentally because I know what I gave up, I know what I had, and I know now it wasn't worth it. What a horrible thought that would be for all eternity. I had the pearl of great price, I was on the road to heaven, and I gave it up for what? All of these pleasures and lust and to make other people happy. Another reason you must never go back to denominationalism is that you cannot have the spiritual blessings that are spoken of in the Bible in religious error. Think about it. Ephesians 1 verse 3 teaches us that all spiritual blessings are ours in Christ. I have every blessing I can imagine in Christ. Acts 4 verse 13, I have the power to be transformed from a life of worthlessness to a life where people can now see me as an example of how to live. I have the hope of the resurrection, that when my body goes into the grave, we'll be reunited with the Spirit, and that one day we'll have the resurrection unto life. I have the hope and the joy that my sins have been washed away, that the Lord has added me to the church. And if I give that up, I lose out on all that. I know that God does hear the prayer of the righteous, but I also know God does not hear the prayer of sinners. Psalm 66 and verse 18. I cannot, if I go back into denominationalism and religious error, I cannot expect God to hear my prayer and to be pleased with me. You will lose out on the ability, the privilege to look up into heaven and say, Our Father who art in heaven. That will no longer be yours if you go back into religious error. But more than that, we want you to know and want to make it as clear and as plain as we can. The Bible says, if you go into denominationalism having been a member of the church, you will not make it to heaven. 2 Timothy 1 verse 10 teaches us that salvation is in Christ. It's God's plan. 2 Timothy 2 verses 10 through 12, salvation is in Christ. If the body of Christ is the church of Christ, Ephesians 1, 22 and 23, and if I leave the body of Christ, I'm not going to be saved in the last day. Revelation 22 verse 14 says, blessed are those who keep His commandments. If one of His commandments is, be faithful unto death, and I don't keep that, I won't be saved. Revelation chapter 14 verse 4 teaches us that those who will be with the redeemed of the ages are those who follow the Lamb wheresoever He went. Now, friend, you can't follow the Lamb, Jesus Christ, into denominationalism because Jesus never went there. Psalm 119 verse 89 teaches us that God's Word is already settled in heaven. If the matter has already been decided and I go against what Scripture has taught, then I cannot be right with God and expect one day to live in heaven if I've lived in direct opposition to the Word and the will of the Master here on this earth. And be sure, we're not your enemy when we speak the truth. Galatians 4 verse 16 says, you don't become somebody's enemy by speaking the truth. We must say what God has said. It's the truth that will set men free. As a member of the body of Christ, I can know that I have eternal life. 1 John 5 and verse 13, I can know that I'm inside His body. I can be sure that there is only one way, Matthew 7 verse 13 and 14, and I can be sure if I give up on that, there's no hope left for me. And so you must never, ever go back into denominationalism. We ask you today, Are you a part of that which divides in Christianity? Or are you a part of the one body of Christ? Are you a part of a group that follows the teachings of certain men? Maybe certain men like John Calvin or Martin Luther or John Knox or John Wesley, or maybe people who came not long after the apostles but were not inspired men. Are you following the teaching of men? Is the group that you're a part of, can it be found inside the pages of this book, or did it come thousands of years later? If it's not in here, you can be sure it's not right with God, and it is denominationalism. Now, I know some may be thinking today, well, that sounds hard. You're saying all these people are going to be lost? We're not trying to emphasize how others are going to be lost. We're trying to emphasize what people need to do to be right with God. If you were sick and you went to the doctor, wouldn't you want the doctor to just come out and tell you, here's the problem, here are your chances, here's what you can do, possibly so that you can live a little longer and have a happy and healthy and productive life? Wouldn't you want that? Why, sure you would. If he didn't tell you that, you'd be upset. Jesus is the great physician. He has all the answers to all the spiritual questions right here in the Word, and much of what people are doing today is not found in the Bible. And thus, we need to listen to what Jesus says when He speaks about religious error and how it will cause people to lose their soul. You can't be saved outside the church. You can't be saved in some man-made plan of salvation. You can't be saved by worshiping God in ways that are not right. The only way you can be saved is to submit to God's will, to follow the purity of New Testament Christianity, and to leave all this division and chaos behind. We're begging you, we're pleading with you, won't you give up denominationalism and just be a Christian? Nothing more, nothing less. Just be a Christian and do what the Bible says, then you can know that you're right with God. If you're not a Christian, we're begging you, become one today. Become a member of the Lord's body, and we beg you, if you're in denominationalism, for the sake of your soul, come out from among them and be separate. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wallet.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905 or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111.